born in Barcelona and grew up in Basel. He studied piano at the Royal College of Music in London, graduating with a Bachelor's of Music with honors. As a pianist and composer, he has won competitions internationally, and most recently was on tour with his compositions and arrangements in China and Malta. At the Paul Stiftung in Basel, he undertook substantial research on the sketch materials of Church Ligeti's late works and Elliot Carter's works from the 1950s and Igor Stravinsky's Firebird. He is currently a PhD student candidate in music theory at Yale University, working on a dissertation that investigates late 19th century European intellectual networks through which music philosophy was disseminated. The special focus in his work is the work of Edmund Gurney, and late Victorian discourses of evolutionary theory and music psychology. Secondary interests concern sonata theory, turn of the century, 20th century history of theory, and music and politics. It's my pleasure to introduce Miklós, who will give the presentation entitled, I Will Follow the Way I Choose, Revisiting the Ambiguity of Dmitri Shostakovich's Fifth Symphony, Phenomena.
Instigated Pravda article titled, Muddle Instead of Music Denounced the Opera. At the time, Shostakovich was writing his Fourth Symphony, which he feared would not fare better. Nevertheless, he completed it and started rehearsals for its premiere scheduled for December 11, 1936. The premiere never occurred. It is unclear whether Shostakovich preemptively withdrew it himself or he was forced to do so. In any case, his fear would have been well justified, since artists, intellectuals, and public officials around the Soviet Union were being executed as part of Stalin's Great Terror campaign. The following year, 1937, Shostakovich kept his head down and worked on a few songs and his Fifth Symphony. Tentatively, he reemerged on November 21st with its premiere. It was a resounding success. The work was canonized swiftly, and his rehabilitation followed soon thereafter. 2 months later, he apparently characterized it in the Vechernaya Moskva, an evening newspaper, as a Soviet artist's creative response to just criticism, with which the work was thenceforth identified. It is unclear whether Shostakovich himself authored it. Richard Ruskin has suggested that he did, and surreptitiously attributed it to some anonymous reviewer to dissimulate his true intentions, whatever they may have been. At any rate, the final passage, almost 2 minutes of a pounding tutti fortissimo in the work's triumphant tonic major, soon raised suspicions of the statement's insincerity. Shostakovich confirmed that the final passage that you just heard was in fact meant unambiguously to mock his oppressors, a reading that had been unofficially floating around since its premiere. He wrote, quote, it's as though someone were beating you with a stick, saying, your business is rejoicing, your business is rejoicing. And you rise up shakily and go on your way muttering, our business is rejoicing, our business is rejoicing. What kind of apotheosis is that? You have to be be a complete oaf not to hear that." Unquote. Ian MacDonald, in his revisionist biography of Shostakovich based on Volkov's testimony, went so far as to call it, quote, "a shocking intrusion of cartoon satire," unquote. Laurel Fay immediately challenged the authenticity of Volkov's testimony. Scholars were confused, and some backed her, notably Richard Truskin, who in response to MacDonald pointed out that it would have been suicide on Shostakovich's part to compose mockery. He said, quote, "if any oaf could hear the shocking intrusion of cartoon satire, so could any informer," unquote. To this day, Volkov's story persists in program notes. But in 2018, Pauline Fairclough concluded that, quote, "all contemporary scholarship now rejects Volkov's posturing." So, is this final passage ambiguous or not? By scholarly consensus, it is. The meaning of the symphony is particularly ambiguous. The final passage is its ambiguous climax. For example, Truskin has called it, quote, "a richly coded utterance, but one whose meaning can never be wholly encompassed," or definitely paraphrased, unquote. And Ina Varshava has suggested that precisely this ambiguity may be the symphony's very meaning. Apart from the Vecherniaya article of dubious authorship, Shostakovich was judicially silent about the work and would reply to questions about its meaning by pointing to the score. In one of the very few unchallenged comments, he was quoted by his son as stating the finale's message as, quote, "I am right, I will follow the way I choose," unquote. The comment's context makes clear that this resolute message is meant to contrast with the less resolute messages of the previous movements. But even that comment is potentially partially supported by the Vecherniaya article, in which we read, quote, "the symphony's finale resolves the tense and tragic moments of the preceding movements in a joyous, optimistic fashion," unquote. Does this therefore invalidate what his son reported? Or conversely, does it prove the sincerity of the Vecherniaya article? As we see, the core of every hermeneutic comment on the symphony has been that the finale, particularly the final passage, somehow puts the experience of the previous music in a new light. But what it does, whether it is mockery of or collaboration with Stalin, is ambiguous. In grappling with this question, many analysts have researched the motifs and themes, and talked about his connection to other works. But surprisingly, nobody has taken a careful look at the structure of the score, which is what Shostakovich directed us to do after all. So now I ask, could a formalist analysis of the work provide a clue to explain its ambiguity? Could it be that in the context of the symphonic tradition, it is formally as ambiguous as its reception? This movement has many of the trappings of sonata form, and therefore will be analyzed as such. Sonata form is the structure used for almost every first and many last movements of multi-movement instrumental works from the classical era onwards. Shostakovich is known to have been instructed in Adolf Bernhard Marx's theory of sonata form from the 1830s. And obviously, he knew a great deal of repertoire in sonata form as well. I'll be using the most recent version of the theory, posited by James Hipokoski and Warren Darcy. But in principle, the point can be made with any theory of sonata form. In its prototypical layout, the sonata movement, known in Hipokoski's and Darcy's system as the type 3 sonata, has three sections: an exposition, a development, and recapitulation. In the exposition, there is a primary and a secondary theme. The primary is in the tonic key, here represented as 1. The secondary is in some other key, often the dominant, here as 5. This key is confirmed at the so-called essential expositional closure, or EEC, which is a major cadence in this arrival key. It is followed by a closing theme. The development section is very free, and almost anything can happen in it. Usually it begins with a primary theme in the arrival key, then rotates through the themes in a similar order to the exposition, and ends on a dominant lock. The recapitulation is the same as the exposition, only that all the themes are usually in the tonic key. And the essential expositional closure is here the essential structural closure, or ESC, since it confirms the tonic of the entire movement. A coda may be added that often features prominently the primary theme and ends in the tonic. This is strictly optional and confirms that the sonata form proper has been concluded. There's wide agreement in the history of music theory about this basic layout in its broadest strokes. Now, the advantage of Hippokoski's and Darcy's sonata form is the concept of rotation. As we see, the primary theme begins each new section. Sonata theory calls each period between major primary theme appearances rotations. Since we have three rotations in sonata form proper, we call it a tri-rotational sonata, with the expositional, developmental, and recapitulatory rotations. The concept of rotation allows us to talk about a rarer alternative format, the so-called type 2 sonata, which Marx's version of the theory cannot account for, but nevertheless makes significant appearances throughout the classical and romantic eras. The type 2 fuses the development and the recapitulation into one section with one rotation, yielding a bi-rotational sonata with an exposition and a recapitulatory rotation, but strictly speaking, no development or recapitulation as such. The essential characteristics that remain the same in both are the exposition and the opening of the development, as well as the end of the recapitulatory rotation. Finally, I would like to draw attention to the coda, which seals off the preceding structure, whatever the type of sonata. As we will see, Shostakovich problematizes these models. His exposition and coda are clear, but everything in between is extremely ambiguous. Now, why does this matter? Because the form of the movement forces us and every listener familiar with Western classical music to ask the most foundational questions about what it is that we are hearing. But only because the frame is so unambiguously clear. For contrast, take a look at Arnold Schoenberg's Verklärte Nacht from 1899. It features an exposition with somewhere between 5 and 12 distinct themes, a few of which are vaguely recalled in a more developmental section with fewer themes. There are no cadences whatsoever, so it is wrong to speak of themes being in keys anyway. When we return to the tonic major, we get a completely new, unrelated section that only with enormous effort could be argued to overwrite the exposition. In a sort of coda, some of the opening themes are dreamily recalled in a transformed fashion. This movement is so tangentially related to anything that looks like a sonata that one should be discussing how useful sonata form is altogether in describing this form. But in Shostakovich, I repeat, the exposition and coda are such classic textbook examples of what is supposed to happen in any sonata that it begs the question what to make of that in between. With this in mind, let's dive into the details. I have added bar numbers on the top for those who might want to follow the presentation with the score. In bold are the page numbers of the 2 piano reduction you can retrieve from the link on the top of my page. I designed my analysis in such a way that you should be able to follow without having to look at the score. Let us start with the exposition, which has a few changes that prefigure the later major ambiguities. We hear the primary theme in 2 parts. The first. Toward the end of the second, you can hear that the music is dissolves into a flurry of activity in the strings, known as Falschspinnung, or spinning forth, here abbreviated as FS. This is typical of primary themes that do not include a transition to the secondary theme, which is technically the norm. Eventually, out of this Falschspinnung emerges a new theme in the trumpet. This has generally been understood to be the secondary theme. It is not quite clear what key it is. It starts in E flat and then moves to A flat. In any case, the music continues on an E dominant pedal that leads us to a glorious perfect authentic cadence on A. Which sonata theory calls, quote, the most important generic and tonal goal of the exposition, the moment when the secondary theme attains satisfactory perfect authentic cadence in the new key and gives way to differing material, unquote, namely the closing theme, as you see here. Nevertheless, what follows this apparent essential expositional closure is not differing material, but a grandiose, expanded restatement of the trumpet theme we just heard earlier. Now, this is a big problem. This restatement makes the labels for the secondary theme and the closing themes mutually exclusive. Let me explain why. On the face of it, the music following the cadence comes across as an overpowering closing theme. Closing themes tend to have a jubilant, tonic-forming character, and this one simply fits the part pretty well, as you just heard. The confidence of the apparent essential expositional closure confirms the impression that the preceding music was an extension of the initial Falschspinnung rather than an independent secondary theme. This would mean that the exposition has been continuous instead of two-part, which is an uncommon but important alternative used in such pieces as Beethoven's Third Symphony. If we compare in detail the trumpet theme to its restatement, we see that the trumpet theme is incomplete. It is the restatement's version of the theme that will be quoted later in the development. Is not merely a variant of the trumpet theme, but rather its complete form from which, retrospectively, the earlier trumpet theme is derived. Moreover, the accompaniment of the initial trumpet theme strongly resists harmonic categorization and seems to support hearing it as transitional. All this would suggest that the initial trumpet theme is to be heard instead of as a theme in its own right, as an anticipation of the grandiose post-essential expositional closure restatement. It is now recognized as the closing theme, the proper thematic anchor point of this perplexing second half of the exposition. By contrast, that interpretation is challenged when the radiant major dominant harmony established by the essential expositional closure and unchallenged by the beginning of the closing theme is subsequently undermined. Cadence identified provisionally as the essential expositional closure may have been less momentous than previously thought. One is forced to consider whether what seems to be the closing theme is not actually just a repetition of the earlier trumpet theme that relegates the essential expositional closure to the status of a passing cadence that merely subdivides the secondary theme space. Since there's no further cadence before the development section, the exposition would be, quote, a failed exposition which threatens the entire sonata with non-closure and recapitulation. Structural closure is shifted beyond the action of sonata space into not-sonata zone of contingency beyond and external to the standard narrative action of the sonata proper, namely the coda. This is precisely what will happen, which is why, ultimately, it is defensible to label the trumpet theme the secondary theme, along with its restatement. The development section and second rotation begin relatively straightforwardly with a haunted version of the opening primary theme. We've clearly entered the development section. Several measures later, the momentum finally breaks and a calmer texture sets in. It is the development proper that features fragments of both the primary and secondary themes, as we heard before. The development section is usually thought to end here. Whether the recapitulation section itself reoccurs, begins here as well. In general, rotations merely register notable recurrences of the primary theme or its equivalent, as I explained at the beginning. By themselves, however, rotations do not necessitate a section change. Section changes are accompanied typically by a number of other markers. To begin the recapitulation section of a textbook type sonata, a recapitulatory rotation, that is, the return of the primary theme, is a necessary but not sufficient condition. In the present case, two further generic markers, the return of the tonic and the cessation of developmental activity, are ambiguous, and hence call into question that the recapitulation section actually begins here. You may remember that the primary theme at the very beginning also had a second primary theme. Now, the tonic appears at the end of what we thought was the development section with the second primary theme in augmentation. So you hear that, it is the much slower version of that second primary theme that we heard. A case could be made for beginning the recapitulation here, along with the recapitulatory rotation. The second and not the first primary theme would be the rotation initiator. But then we'd have to reorient primary theme space toward the second primary theme and away from the first, which would be seen as a framing device rather than the leading theme of the movement. This is insofar plausible as it would have a precedent in the design of the primary theme space in the first movement of the symphony. That the development section does not begin with the primary theme is less serious, since development sections are in all ways more flexible than the other sections. But this music intuitively seems too strongly embedded in developmental space to warrant such a move, and besides, later treatments of the primary theme make the first primary theme the exclusive center of attention. In fact, the second primary theme does not occur again. Nevertheless, the appearance of the first primary theme is also problematic because it is undercut by a dominant lock. Here it is again. That's the dominant, that is the bottom of the timpani. So, as we recall, the dominant lock is one of the generic markers of the final stage of the development, and therefore not yet the recapitulation. To reconcile the dominant lock with the formally conflicting first primary theme, one might consider the possibility of a type 2 sonata instead of a recapitulatory rotation. The first primary theme would initiate merely a semi-developmental sub-rotation. That it appears in augmentation exactly as it did at the beginning of the development section would support this interpretation. The dominant lock, rather than the end of the development section, would be a preparation for a triumphant secondary theme, of which one would expect a tonal resolution. That is, a confirmation of the tonic key of D, either major or minor. Unfortunately, that prediction is too simple to be true. It is highly ambiguous whether the secondary theme materializes at all. This is very serious indeed. It is required to conclude whatever formal section the music is in. The dominant lock dissolves if the first primary theme continues in fragments against a new counterpoint in running eighths. In this example, the timpani is very faintly holding on to the dominant until the very end. Dominant lock would have predicted. Thankfully, there is one redeeming detail further on, another dominant lock. Under normal circumstances, it would be hard to imagine the listener actually tracking an implied dominant pedal in the background across 60 measures of intervening music. The fact that those 60 measures are so obviously developmental, in fact, justifies it. But if their function is merely a prolongation of the dominant, then we're still in the development and not in the recapitulation section. Could one imagine beginning the recapitulation after that? The analysis of the music leading up to this does not rule out such an interpretation. But after a few measures, we realize that the cadence we just heard must have been, quote, the goal toward which the entire sonata trajectory has been aimed, unquote, namely the central structural closure. It is the moment of truth where, much like at the apparent essential expositional closure earlier on in the exposition, one is forced to reconsider the formal status of the preceding section. overwhelming rhetorical force asserts that it is the coda, quote, the concluding passage of a movement, an addition to the basic structure, unquote. But again, what is that basic structure? What structure does it conclude? A type 3 sonata without a recapitulation? A type 2 sonata with only a shadow of its required secondary theme? No single solution has been able to account for the observed phenomena. There are two last resort solutions for the form of this movement. A secret weapon of sonata theory is the, quote, anti-recapitulation, an extremely rare, extreme deformation registering some catastrophe or act of violence that has befallen the structure as a whole, unquote. The other, more pragmatic side of the same coin is to give up on formal characterization of this huge middle section altogether. But even so, either way, the unambiguous exposition, beginning of developmental space, and coda beg the question of what happened to the recapitulation, or at the very least, why what might have been a recapitulation is so ambiguous. Why an anti-recapitulation? Why no form at all? The coda's answer is to forget those questions. Shostakovich's words, quote, I am right, I will follow the way I choose, unquote, are temptingly appropriate. It is as if the triumphant D major tutti fortissimo pounded them into the listener for 2 minutes. Because the potential for harmonic, thematic, and formal recapitulatory closure is cut through by the notorious coda. This is not a problem created by the method of sonata theory. Some sort of recapitulatory resolution, whether harmonic, thematic, or formal, following the development, has been one of sonata form's definitional characteristics throughout its history, and especially in Marx's version of its theory, that prizes the dialectical balance of formal sections through their purposive recurrence. When confronted with such extreme ambiguities, Marx's theory reminds the reader, quote, to take into account the particular content, idea, mood, etc., of the particular work, unquote. Sonata theory, by contrast, has been a much more powerful method to formalize the problem and understand the complexity of the Gordian knot that the question of the formal status of the middle section of this piece represents. The coda cut through it by closing the section and thus extinguished the hope for a proper resolution. Formal ambiguities I proposed are the implicit tensions that would have been and continue to be registered subconsciously by listeners literate in the music of the Western canon. Therefore, they may well contribute to the enduring fascination with his music. The music theoretical intricacies I uncovered may help us transcend the binary traitor or collaborator views of Shostakovich that have plagued him and so many others under repression. It is ambiguous. And there's so much more to this music than its relation to the regime, that audiences responded to and continue to respond to the work in unambiguously positive terms may be due not only to the historical circumstances of its creation, its subtle motivic connections, and the sheer impressiveness of some 100 musicians playing loudly together in its triumphant coda, but also to the coda's dissolution of the immense and highly complex tension created by the preceding finale and symphony.
please sort of identify who you are so the audience knows who you are and also Miklós knows you as well?
It's Cameron Logan. And my question is related to Shostakovich's reading of Marx.
Mm-hmm.
So in Marx's Manual on Musical Composition,
mm-hmm.
he discusses form. Maybe you can help my memory, but he builds a kind of taxonomy of form where there are simple forms like binary, ternary, and these build up to the sonata form.
That's right.
And then there's a form above sonata form.
It's a multi-movement work, yeah.
Yeah, I forget the label, but it's either fantasy or rhapsody. And is it possible that Shostakovich is thinking about that form above sonata form in this movement of the Fifth Symphony?
That's a really good question. I mean, for those that are not familiar with Marx's theory, so he comes up with this theory of form that starts out with a single note. And then through dialectical growth, it goes into, and then that becomes the smallest unit of music, and then he keeps building that. That smallest unit becomes then a phrase, and then the phrase gets put together with more pieces, and then he keeps building up more and more, and every step in the growth is justified by his dialectical principles of growth. And his almost the highest form is sonata form, in which he believes that there's this perfect balance between the different sections. And then, I'm not that familiar with the fantasy form or the rhapsody.
Right. I mean, I think it's briefly dealt with, but it is referenced that there's something beyond sonata form.
Yeah. I mean, again, I would just say that it is so clear what he's doing at the beginning and end. That you could say, okay, well then that middle section might be something really cool, something that somehow we actually can understand if we go to a higher transcendent level. But at the same time, we do have those two anchor points, which is like, this is what it is. Now do something with that. You know what it is? Now tell me what it is, and it's hard to understand what's going on in the middle. I mean, maybe talking about the Schönberg that I also quoted, but lots of other movement that Schönberg. I mean, Marx's theory might say, well, that Schönberg is one of these really cool other things, and then there are these suggestions of making multi-movement forms in one. That would apply to Schönberg, and the argument has been made. But I just don't see that being done with Shostakovich, especially since it is the last movement of a symphony, a very classical symphony. So it's not like he's going to have one straightforward movement. Well, of course, it's not straightforward. It has all these really complicated intricacies, then a second straightforward movement, third straightforward movement, and then just... Maybe. But I just see him pointing in the direction that I've tried to analyze it in, and forcing us to bash our head against these problems. But I will look into it, and thank you very much for reminding me of that.
My name is Jacob Lodgett. I'm a second year doctoral candidate in composition.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering about the theme of the finale. To me, is reminiscent of Mahler's Ninth Symphony,
mm-hmm.
the third movement, the Rondo Burlesque.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering if any quotation like that of Western composers would have been seen as antithetical to the Soviet sense of nationalism, or if that would have even caught the attention of those who would have been trying to see that.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of work on this symphony about its inter-movement, inter-work connections to other movements by Mahler, by Beethoven, and then to his own music. I mean, this is Opus 47. Opus 46 was a bunch of songs, one of which is titled Rebirth, and it has a texture that is literally identical to what's happening in the development section. And the text to that is talking about the barbarian artist that has been sleeping and has been repressed and then wakes up. And it's very tempting to read it that way. That's, in fact, what Volkov read it as, and then Ian MacDonald. The connection is too obvious not to ignore it. it's a very valid point to make that. There are also other quotations to Tchaikovsky's Romeo and Juliet in the development section, but in a kind of weird, transformed fashion, which is again, it seems to be crying out for something. And I've just not addressed that because that work has been done really well, and this hasn't. So that's why I'm focusing on this. Yeah?
Just a couple of several things here. Number one, you know, what's fascinating about the sonata form is that, you know, some scholars and theorists, you know, talk about the dichotomy between a two-part, you know, structure and a three-part structure.
Yes, that's right.
Because I mean, if you look at, you know, the course of time, the manifestation of the sonata form, you see, like in opus 2, number 1, first movement, you see the, you know, the large reprise organization of the
body.
In opus 2, number 1, you know, has 50 measures, 50 measures, 50 measures for exposition, development, recapitulation. So again, that I think that that's a factor that plays in here.
Yeah.
You know, is it three? Is it two?
Yeah.
That's that dichotomy of two and three. Again, I know that with, you know, Halcyon and Darcy, you know, their whole, you know, what should I say, mission is to come up with, you know, a generalized theory of, you know, sonata form. And yet, you know, what's very important, I think, in all analysis is, as Benjamin Boritz would say, is context.
Yeah.
And I think what you're trying to sort of demonstrate here today is the context, you know, the special qualities that sort of identify the unique facets of this piece. So that's my second point. Then the third point has to do with the whole notion, as Leonard Meyer talks about, you know, the expectation, and then the realization when you don't get what you expect, and then all of a sudden here either you do a retrospection or you do what Meyer calls a projection.
Yeah.
In order to sort of like, you know, try to define what has happened.
Yeah.
And I think you've done that, whether or not you were aware of it, you know, brilliantly, where we expect this and that. And then the summary thing is we see in Haydn the whole notion, even in his late works, and I think you could address this better than I, is the notion of continuous development throughout the form.
Yeah.
And of course, we see that in Brahms, where we see the fusion in late Brahms of the development and the recapitulation. There's often, you know, Brahms just does not restate, you know, the primary theme because it's developed intensely in the development, and then we begin the so-called recapitulation with the second theme.
Yeah.
So I think, you know, there are many facets here, I think. You know, you're taking into the sociological, political, and contextual, which I think is a very rich and wonderful analysis on this. So I just want to put those three factors out again, the dichotomy of two and three, and also the whole notion of anticipation and then the realization, which I think, you know, lends to really then my final comment, the narrative and the drama of the piece.
Okay, I'll address the four or five points
okay. I just put those three things out there.
So first of all, whether it's two or three part, that question arises when you have a repetition of the first part. So you have a repetition of the first part, and then you have that second big part, which is development and recapitulation.
Right.
So that is how you get that balance. There's no question of a repetition of anything in this. I mean, that was an option that was dropped.
So you don't get a recurrence of the exposition as the recapitulation. I mean, you don't get that third really definition in this piece, right?
No. That's the big question: whether you get that or not. I mean, it's definitely ambiguous. But I think that the question of asking whether there's a two or three part form in the 1780s sense is a question that would not necessarily be appropriate after the 1830s, just because that is an anachronistic thing to do with it after the 1830s, more or less. I mean, Brahms was still doing things like that,
right.
And that would be a very classicizing feature. That I mean, Prokofiev was doing not too far before this in his classical symphony, but he's also taught in the classical symphony. And it's clear what he wants to do. Okay, your third comment was context. Your second comment was?
Also about the anticipation and realization. So you expect, to get, the first thing back and you don't.
So that's an interesting question.
But it heightens the drama, and when there's a hiatus of not fulfilling an expectation, Herr Barta, it creates a tension and so forth.
Yeah, I think that's a great point, because that is exactly what the language
perspective
is, like he's confirming something that never happened, and that is really what this movement is about. You really hit that. Then your other comment, context. Obviously this is 1937. Sonata form had been around since, if you really want to stretch it, since somewhere in the 1760s. So a very long time. And a lot of things had been done with it already, not just in the last 50 years before he wrote it, but in the first 50 years that it had been composed. So there's an awful lot that went on, especially in the late 19th, early 20th century. Crazy things were being done, especially by Schoenberg. That's why I brought up this one example. And sonata form was something of a retrospective form, but also a very prestigious form. And Soviet Russia, we saw how in the second generation, the second age of the symphony, in Europe in the late 19th century, we had all these symphonies, all these sonata forms, all this prestigious form coming up all over the place to justify individual nationalistic traditions. The sonata form was still a very prestigious form, although it was maybe more old established form. So in the context of that, he is definitely looking back in a way. But he's also looking back through the lens, through the cloud, through the fog of so much stuff that has been going on. And sonata form being changed and transformed into nothing. I mean, particularly Schoenberg, it's for me, one of the examples that are really the very furthest from anything that could be sonata form. And given that history, he's definitely more conservative. But I think that it's fair enough to say that he still is in dialogue with the principles of sonata form. This is not like he's just making up something from scratch that happens to look like sonata form, but he's really working with it and changing it, and building with that tension. What else? What else?
Well, I have just one other thing, and I don't mean to monopolize the questions here, but there's also too a great tradition established with Tchaikovsky.
Yeah.
The epilogue.
Yeah.
The epilogue is different than a coda. The epilogue is when, in dance, and I just recently saw the Sleeping Beauty and its complete presentation by the Bolshoi, and blew my mind away for 3 hours. Like, wow, just when you think it's coming to an end at the very end, all of a sudden here, something new is introduced. And that's what an epilogue basically does. It doesn't bring really closure. All of a sudden it opens up a dimension at the end that, dance you get that, of course. But he also does have in symphonies too. But have you considered the notion of this finale having basically features of the epilogue?
One example that might play a role here is the 1812 overture, which is built really symmetrically in both directions, in which you start with an introduction, then you have this other bit, and then you start with the sonata proper, which is built exactly symmetrically. It's a two-part sonata. That is a two-part sonata.
Okay.
And then you just start getting the pieces that you already heard, and then at the end you just have this grandiose.
Well, rather than anticipation, you get the perspective.
Yeah, but
the opposite of anticipation.
But just having that opening chorale come back with such magnificence, it's really strange in that that it comes back with such glory. It has a similar function as this in some sense, because we've heard the primary theme already 3 or 4 times. In this kind of dark, haunted version, and then it comes back all of a sudden major, and only the first little snippet of it repeated and repeated and repeated. I mean, this is a different thing altogether.
Yeah, I don't mean law, but I'm sure there are other questions here.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, I would browse. Are you arguing that potentially for an apolitical reading of this last movement, or of the symphony as a whole? And if you are, how would you specifically advise Volkov and the other political readers of the symphony?
Okay, so let me just say that I want to make a presentation that makes all these questions more complicated, but does not answer them. So I want you guys to go and think that these are really complicated questions, but not try to say it, that's what it is. So the political reading, I would just like to say that there is an apolitical dimension of it, as every piece of music does have. Just in this particular story, the political reading looms over everybody's head all the time. And I'm not saying that it doesn't matter, I'm just saying that the apolitical aspect of it, that this is a very complex, very interesting piece of music, definitely has fired up the huge political speculation.
What is there a similar reception, let's say, among modern Russian critics?
A similar reception?
Yes, a similar attitude, saying that we have to go beyond the folklore.
Again, I just want to correct. I mean, I don't want to say we must do this. Yeah. We should do this. I mean, obviously, you can always say, yeah, the musical absolutist, the Hanslick tradition in which we have the absolute artwork that you just must study on its own merits. Yeah, I mean, I think that's a valid point. I think the political questions are also a valid point. I just want to make them a little bit more complicated. I want to complexify the questions the way that we're asking. I want to look at, well, what does the structure have to say? Could that be a complicating factor in all these more or less facile answers we're giving? So Volkov, my honest opinion is that I don't care. I don't actually have an opinion whether Volkov is right or he's not right, whether Stalin, whether he was mocking Stalin or whether he wasn't. I think these are interesting questions, and they're made even more interesting by what I have to contribute to them. That's my.
Yeah. Hi, Sam. So I understand not wanting to kind of go into a certain camp, but I am wondering, when we're analyzing the form, when we're analyzing certain aspects of this music, what are certain things we could look for to say, okay, this, we can make the case that this is, you know, mocking Stalin, or we can make the case that this is falling in line with Stalin. Like, what are musical things we could look for to say one thing or the other?
Well, the classic example that people have taken is this quote from his song, which he was writing at exactly the same time, which has this text of the barbarian artist that is sleeping, and it has this vision of new clarity and new freedom. And it's pretty clear that if he's quoting that in his recapitulation, and then you have this angry return of the theme, and then this really forced, I mean, you could characterize this forced coda. It's like, you know, this guy's repressed, and then finally, one day, he's going to awaken, but no, the regime is there, and it's going to punch him down. And it's going to force him to sing what he really should be singing when he's free. That is the classic way to go. And there are connections in the other movements that could be made as well. That, however, is the same way that people go when talking about the opposite, because you can say, well, that force jubilation might be his actual jubilation. And in fact, if we look at his comments, whether they're authentic or not, that's what he was saying.
Right.
To what extent does your analysis
identify yourself?
Oh, well, sorry, I'm Edward Cumming, I conduct the orchestra here.
Thank you.
To what extent does your analysis take Shostakovich's tempi? You didn't talk about tempo, and the recording you played opens with a blatant disregard of Shostakovich's specific tempo, and the fact that it begins slow and it ends slow, and Shostakovich is more specific about all the tempo changes in this movement than maybe any other symphonic movement, in the way it keeps changing it. And the beginning, the way it actually gradually gets faster and faster and faster until it arrives at what you call the second of the first two themes.
Yeah.
So talk about how tempo, because
Okay, that's an excellent question that I wasn't able to address, so I'm happy about that opportunity. So the recording you heard was 1982 Mravinsky and the Leningrad Symphony. I chose that one just because I like it most, and it is one of the shortest that I heard. I like it to be really fast, and I like the last bit to be really slow. And this is what it did. You're very right. That is too fast.
Interrupt briefly. Is that because when Bernstein brought the New York Philharmonic to Russia, the Soviet Union, sorry, at the time, and did also play the tempi much faster than Shostakovich's, and Shostakovich, I guess, was okay with it. He didn't say anything about it. You don't know really what he really thought. But that happened before this recording, right? Did it become like a new, like, de rigueur tempo for orchestras to do that?
So I don't know that particular recording by Bernstein, but I do recall that
it was a performance that when he took the orchestra on tour, it wasn't recorded.
Yeah, so I do recall that the recording that exists, he does the very last section much faster, which personally I disagree with. There's this question, and his son has a testament about that Shostakovich meant the last section to be slower, in fact, and that there was a mistake in the publication. It added, what was it? It gave the wrong note value equals 180 or something like that. So many times the mistake was taken literally by Bernstein, amongst other people, and done exactly twice as fast as it's supposed to be. Now his son said that is a mistake. That is an obvious mistake. So I agree, personally, I like the performances that take the last section slower. On the other point, that it started too fast, that is a really good point. Shostakovich, in fact, did have, as you pointed out, a little bit slower beginning that keeps accelerating and accelerating and accelerating until that return of the first theme in augmentation at the beginning of the development section, which is a very interesting thing because that potentially puts the whole form in a little bit different light. Because if you have an acceleration, 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 then all the time stop, it would suggest that stop is meant to mean something. But in fact, this formal perspective that I presented says, well, the stop comes actually a little bit before. So if you just look at the tempi, you would end up with a slightly different form than I have presented. In light of that, yes, I prefer one that is not quite to the score. It was a compromise. This is just the one that I've been listening to and that I really like. It's not quite perfect at the beginning, but I just really like that energy and excitement that most of the movement does have, and then the contrast. I just like that sense of contrast, which could have been caught a little bit better at the beginning.
Well, to what extent do you think sonata form really is a form, and how much is a process? Because so many components, you mentioned Brahms as being someone who held to it, but there are probably, if you ask people in this room, we would all come to disagreement as to whether there's a development in the finale of this first symphony. Some people say no, some people say yes.
Is this Shostakovich?
No, Brahms.
Oh, Brahms, yeah.
First symphony. And because Brahms simply took the development and put it after the recapitulation started.
Yeah.
Just moved it. You know? So it's really hard, particularly since Marx comes up with this, you know, like, as you said, 7 years after composers have already been doing it. So, I mean, how much of this is really a form, and how much of this, the fact that composers like Shostakovich, like Brahms, just like to play with expectations?
Yeah, and that's another very good point. But I think that the very mention of the word expectation, how are you going to have an expectation if every single composer that is doing something we today call sonata form is inventing it from scratch? How can it be that there are all these processes and they all end up in something that is so similar without having some sort of a normative framework which they all are in some sort of dialogue with? It's like when we're speaking English. I mean, there is a sense in which there is a correct pronunciation, there is a correct grammar, and then there's a less correct. Obviously, that is also a process. I mean, who defines what is correct English? Well, I don't know. It's a social fact. It's dictionaries that define it. But what more is there to say that is correct definition, that is correct English by definition? What is that definition? What is that authority that says that that's what it is? I mean, necessarily, tautologically, sonata form, yes, it doesn't exist. It is an intersubjective fact. But I think it's an intersubjective fact that does have very clear boundaries of what counts and what doesn't. What can fit into the model and what doesn't. And therefore, just a repertoire of music to which an overwhelming number of testaments have been made. So I think that there is such a thing as sonata form as an intersubjective fact amongst composers and listeners that is made reference to. And I tried in this, towards the beginning of my presentation, to point out what are the very bare fundamentals of sonata form that really go beyond any particular form.
Well, piggybacking on Professor Brauss, sorry, I came in late, so I don't know if you talked about this, but I mean, Shostakovich, he was under pressure his whole life.
Yeah.
But maybe never more so than this period, because that article, Muddle or Music, had just come out a year or two before, and he pulled his fourth symphony because he knew that he would have been destroyed if he had made that public.
Yeah.
And didn't even bring it out until after Stalin died.
Yeah.
So given that enormous pressure, given that article that had come out, and everybody knew, okay, and then his next symphony is the fifth symphony.
Yeah.
So, even though you can't pinpoint, I know that.
Yeah.
None of us can.
Yeah.
Isn't the fact we keep talking about it because of that article that came out and the pressure on him at that particular point in his compositional life?
That's a very valid point. But then look at, the Fourth Symphony. Why could that not have been the Great Symphony? Well, it didn't have a great climactic ending. I mean, that is really, that may have been an excuse. But then the Sixth Symphony was not well received. Although, he was a superstar after the Fifth. But then the Seventh was great. So, I don't know. Can you attribute it to the music? Well, I don't know. That's the big millennial question that keeps being asked.
And I'm going to have to call time here right now.
Oh, sure.
Excuse me for my revelation here, but I'm sort of the timekeeper here. But I have to call time because it is 1:20, and other people have to go to other classes to go to.
Okay.
So if you have questions, please remain and talk with Miklós. I want to thank you for the wonderful.